And let me get out of my little participants room and we'll be good to go. Good afternoon, early evening, everybody. I know that we have a lot of educators here today. And so I just want to thank you guys in the middle of this storm. No one really knows what's happening from one day to the next. And I know that you guys are doing the very best you can, just trying to navigate being an educator and supporting students of all abilities virtually or in a hybrid scenario, etc. So we really appreciate you taking the time out of your day, taking your energy, and coming to visit us today virtually for a presentation that's all about supporting your student with Down syndrome. So I'm going to assume that the majority of you all are supporting a student with Down syndrome. Although when it comes to this particular presentation and a lot of the educational materials and resources and training we provide, it can really be applied to students of all abilities. It's really about knowing your student. But today we want you to learn a little bit more about your student with Down syndrome, because the more you understand what Down syndrome is, how it impacts a learner with Down syndrome, then the more you can start to understand how to utilize that learner's strengths, how to get to know that learner a little bit better, find good motivators, and really be able to make a meaningful connection to educating that learner with Down syndrome. So that's what we're all about today. And I want to go ahead and start with just a brief introduction. My name is Elizabeth Lewis. I am the Director of Education at Down Syndrome Connection of the Bay Area. I've been with Down Syndrome Connection since 2016. However, I've been working directly through early intervention services and education in schools, both private and public, in home, in small social skills groups. I've been working with individuals with Down syndrome, autism, ADHD for almost 20 years now. So I kind of have a wide array of experiences when it comes to working with individuals with Down syndrome. And I'm hoping that we can bring those experiences as well as some of the data we've collected, the resources and things we've learned over the years to help you support your students and get to know them a little bit better. So the first thing I want to say is I'm here for you if you need me. As the Director of Education, I kind of spearhead all education related things. So if you have a question about your student's education, about an IEP, about troubles or concerns or successes happening at school, virtually, in person, please feel free to reach out to me. I'm happy to provide you with any kind of support that you need in order to help support your student. And we're going to talk a little bit more about that, kind of where we come from, and a little bit more about what brings this presentation to you today. So the Down Syndrome Connection of the Bay Area, if you have not heard of us or worked with us before, we were founded in 1998. You'll see a picture here of Miss Martha, and that's her son Blair. And when Blair was a youngster, Martha decided to start the Down Syndrome Connection of the Bay Area. She wanted to provide, have a place of just community support with other family members who had children or family members with Down syndrome. Just a place for people to connect, to understand a little bit more about the struggles, the successes that they were going through. And then it started to evolve into a fully functioning, operating organization that supports new parents. We have a wonderful, robust medical outreach program where we've partnered with local hospitals to provide good information to new families who are having babies with Down syndrome. We're providing direct services speech and oral motor to, we've done on-site tutoring, we provide consult and training. We have our Educational Alliance, which I'll tell you a little bit about on this page. And then great opportunities for self-advocacy. We have quite a few employees with Down syndrome who have very important roles with our organization. And so our goal is to empower, inspire, and support people with Down syndrome. We want to do the same with their families and the community that serves them while fostering awareness and acceptance in all areas of life. So with the Down Syndrome Education Alliance, we created that about a dozen years ago, recognizing that we wanted so much to serve our community, individuals with Down syndrome, students with Down syndrome and their families. And what we realized is that in order to serve their educational needs, in order to support and foster meaningful education, we would need to partner with the schools. Sorry, let me get out of here. I was just letting someone in here. All right. So we realized that we were missing a huge piece, which was making sure that schools and education teams, specialists, actually had the information they needed, had the tools, the resources, and the support that they needed in order to really support in meaningful ways their students with Down syndrome. So we reached out to Bay Area school districts and eventually started forming these wonderful partnerships. We've partnered with, I don't know how many schools, 40, 50 schools around the Bay Area, dozens of school districts. And now that we're 22 years old, we're really making a big impact in education. As a matter of fact, I've been asked to speak at a leadership conference in February to help other organizations around the country understand how they can build a robust education alliance with their local school districts so that schools in their area can better understand inclusion, better understand meaningful, differentiated instruction, and understand how to support, you know, with best practices their students who have varying abilities. So we're really proud of our Education Alliance. And again, this is a partnership with educators, with the schools, with specialists. We want you to know that we are here as an ally, not an advocate, to hear your concerns, to listen to your candid questions and feedback, and to be able to give you as much meaningful support as we can. So we're here to help you help your student with Down syndrome. So if there's anything at all you need, we're here for you, and feel free to email me anytime with any question you have. We offer consultation. We offer tons of information and resources on our website and through emails and phone calls or virtual Zoom visits, etc. We have tons of materials, evidence-based learning approaches, and a lending library where you can borrow these evidence-based materials and try them with your students. They're not curriculum, they're just different approaches. And so we offer that to our schools and our education teams. We're happy to discuss those options with you. And I'm going to show you a little bit more about what we offer on our website a little bit later in the presentation. But we do have a ton to offer, including trainings like this. I'll also show you how to navigate to a series of trainings we did during this pandemic while everyone was learning virtually and sheltered in place. We came up with our Teach series. And we have tons of different, very specific topics like behavior, communication, IEPs, AAC, etc. Differentiated instruction. So I'll show you later on in our presentation how you can access those PDFs as well if you need just some additional information. Then we also provide our ability awareness presentations. This is one of my favorite parts about this job. I used to love, can't do it anymore right now, but I used to love going to schools all around the Bay Area, sometimes with a self-advocate, Eli, who is employed with Down Syndrome Connection. And we would go to local classrooms, sometimes big assembly style auditoriums, and we would talk about ability awareness. We'd help students understand what Down syndrome is. And then we'd talk about all of the different things, I guess, challenges that come with having Down syndrome, but also all the strengths that come with having Down syndrome. And then we really kind of weighed out all the similarities and people who are typically developing and people with Down syndrome versus the differences, and realized that, you know, they mostly have a lot in common. And so this is a great way to help students in schools understand how to support peers with a disability, how to use respectful language without helping too much, and that they do have more in common with a peer with Down syndrome than they know. So our ability awareness classes are not on site at this time. However, we do offer a virtual ability awareness. I can zoom right into your classroom and we can have an open discussion for students about Down syndrome, about disabilities, and give them a safe space to ask candid questions. Especially if you're working with a student with Down syndrome who's in a general education classroom setting, and maybe their peers aren't quite sure how to engage with them online in a virtual setting. If you are in a classroom setting where you're in a hybrid school scenario, some of my private schools are, then they might even be engaging with your student on site. And this is a great way for them to understand how to support their student with a disability, even if it is virtual. So if you are interested in an ability awareness presentation at your school, please feel free to email me. We can do a personalized, customizable presentation about a specific student, or a very general, broad presentation about Down syndrome in itself. And they're free. These are all free resources for you. So please take advantage of them and let me know if I can visit your virtual classroom in the near future. So let's get into Down syndrome. We call this Down Syndrome 101. We've got a ton of material to cover. I don't want to take any more of your time than we allotted for this presentation. So I'm not going to read through every single bullet point on every single slide that we have in this presentation. I'm going to try to give you some more generalized overviews about the content. And then again, like I said, this PDF will be available for you so that you have it as a reference, and the recording will be available as well. Also, when we created our Road to Success presentation, it kind of was all encompassing. It covers everything. And we have now kind of sectioned some components of this presentation out into that teach series. So if you want even more detailed information about specific subjects like behavior, like accommodations and modifications, or effective strategies for engaging a student with Down syndrome, you can utilize that resource on our website. Get those PDFs, and that'll give you some more information as well. So Down syndrome 101, it is the most commonly occurring chromosomal disorder. 6,000 babies, or about one in every 700 babies in the United States, is born with Down syndrome. So according to the CDC, there are about 250,000 individuals with Down syndrome living in the United States right now. And kind of a common misconception is that the older the mother, the more likely the chance of that child having Down syndrome. But in fact, 80% of babies with Down syndrome are born to women under the age of 35. Kind of a common myth that we like to bust while we're on here. The average lifespan if born with Down syndrome is approximately 55 to 60 years. Now, I will say, with new advances in technology and medicine, you know, we are seeing longer lives and, you know, more ability to thrive as we're able to recognize new medical issues and challenges and address them with modern medicine and technology. And then there are some common physical and mental characteristics of individuals with Down syndrome. We're going to talk about those because they all impact the learning profile, the behavior, and the ability to navigate a school day. And so we're going to go into that, which is where you come in as educators. Now, there are three types of Down syndrome. By far, the most common type is trisomy 21, which is why it's highlighted here in blue. That makes up for about 95% of individuals with Down syndrome. In fact, until very recently, I've never met anyone with any other type of Down syndrome. I don't know if we have at the connection. Until recently, we had the pleasure of meeting a little girl who was only recently diagnosed with mosaic Down syndrome. That is only accounts for about 1% of all cases. And then there's translocation, which is only about 4%. So if you're working with a student with Down syndrome, chances are that student has trisomy 21. The best way we describe this, and I do this in my ability awareness classes, is we take a look at this image on the left here. Kind of looks like a whole bunch of multicolored socks paired up, but those are the chromosomes in your cell. Generally, typically developing people have 23 sets of chromosomes, so 23 pairs. Well, as you can see, if you make your way down, if you find the set of the 21st chromosome down at the bottom here in the middle, you'll see that there are three in that 21st pair. So there's one extra. We got a third sock. And so with that, it's just that simple extra chromosome, 47 instead of 46, that makes up the DNA of someone with Down syndrome. So if you have Down syndrome and you have trisomy 21, you have three copies of the 21st chromosome, which is why World Down Syndrome Day is on 3/21, March 21st, to represent trisomy 21. So I think it's important as an educator to understand that there are some significant medical issues that individuals with Down syndrome face. And we always feel it's important to take a look at a person's health first, right? If you're noticing certain behaviors or you're having, you know, struggles in one area, it may be due to something beyond that individual's control. It may be health related. And there are some health related issues that absolutely impact every student with Down syndrome. And so that's why at the very top, you'll see in bold muscle hypotonia. That is a really important one because what that is it's low muscle tone. Individuals with Down syndrome are born not only with a cognitive disability, but with a physical disability. That hypotonia, every individual with Down syndrome is born with hypotonia. And basically what that means is that the resting muscles are a little bit longer than our typically developing muscles. So because they're longer, they're stretchier. So a typically developing person will have a resting muscle that's just nice and taut right here. And someone with Down syndrome, they're a little bit longer. So it makes it more flexible and stretchy. So if you've noticed your student having really great flexibility, maybe they can take their legs and put them over their head, or they might just do the splits and lay their head down. You also might see tilting of the head. You may see a tongue out. You may see a resting face with like a flat effect. All of those things have to do with hypotonia, not because a student is bored, not because the student is tired. Although he may be bored as well. Not because the student doesn't understand. Hypotonia affects your body from head to toe. And it's very important to understand what that means because that's gonna affect everything here as well. And we're gonna talk about communication and how hypotonia plays a big role in the communication challenges of an individual with Down syndrome. But aside from the communication piece, every muscle is affected. And so therefore, it's more difficult from a developmental standpoint to sit, to crawl, to pull to a stand, to walk, to run. And eventually all of those motor planning processes, obviously to get on a bike and ride a bike. These are things that are very difficult for an individual who has hypotonia. So people with Down syndrome actually have to work two or three times harder than typically developing people to be able to do the same things. So if you've ever had a student in the classroom where you've seen virtually a student who is leaning over, laying his head down, taking a rest, it's because that core, loose and stretchy muscles, legs, arms, fingers, loose and stretchy muscles, difficulty writing, frustrated when trying to write letters or a sentence, loose and stretchy muscles. So that's why muscle hypotonia is in bold up here and why it's very, very important to keep in mind that it can really make a big impact on that student's ability to participate meaningfully. So we want to be mindful about that and try to help accommodate that student, recognizing and coming from a place of empathy that, man, that's got to be hard. I don't have to work nearly as hard as my student with Down syndrome just to keep up. Heart defects, about half of people born with Down syndrome have a hole in their heart. And about 30% of those kiddos end up having to have major heart surgery within the first few months of their lives. So as an educator, it's important to get that kind of information from your from the parents you're working with or family members so that you better understand some of these health issues that your student might be facing, because they can play a big role in that student's ability to participate meaningfully. Some other issues we see are gastrointestinal, hearing and vision, respiratory, sleep apnea. That's a big one. A lot of our kiddos have sleep apnea. So in addition to working their muscles two or three times as hard as everyone else in the classroom, they might not have gotten a good night's sleep the night before. That's another one to ask family members about, to just know about that child's sleeping habits. If sleep apnea can play a role in that kiddo's ability to navigate the whole school day. Some other ones you guys have probably noticed as educators, our kiddos are late bloomers and potty training. We're going to get into that a little bit later. There's also precocious puberty. My colleague before, who has now a 23-year-old son, said that she said, my son, as soon as he finally was potty trained and didn't have to wear a pull-up, we started noticing signs of puberty. So it can be a little bit of a tough time, if you can imagine. Hold on just a second, folks. Got to let someone in here. All right. Okay, sorry about that. Thank you. And then just in general, our students with Down syndrome just have more increased rate of illnesses. They can catch a cold more easily. They produce a lot of mucus. You might see a kiddo with Down syndrome with that compact ENT I have here. They can be big mucus producers. So you might see a lot of clear mucus. It doesn't mean they have a cold. That is just a common common thing that happens as well. And then we also have here in bold, dual diagnosis. So we're learning more and more about how often a child with Down syndrome may have a dual diagnosis. We're still in the infancy of those studies and that research. And in fact, we actually have a brand new series of webinars that we introduced just this month, focusing solely on individuals with an autism and Down syndrome diagnosis. But it is to be noted that about one in every 7 to 8 kiddos born with Down syndrome may have carry a dual diagnosis of autism or ADHD. So always just good to note. So when we talk about learning profile, excuse me, talking too much, gotta have my Topo Chico here. Actually right now, before we go there, since we just covered the medical stuff and the 101 stuff, I'll just take a quick pause to see if anyone has any specific questions. I like to keep things casual here. So we have enough participants, but not too many participants, that if you want to raise a hand, I think we have that hand raising feature. If we don't, you're welcome to ask any message you'd like in our chat feature. Let's see if we have any. And I'll see a virtual hand raising opportunity here, then you're welcome to just raise a hand and ask a question if you have one. And I'm going to scroll here to just take a couple of minutes to see if we've got anyone who has a question. Why isn't this working for me? Okay, just looking. And if I don't see you, feel free to unmute yourself and just ask away if you'd like. Okay. All right. Looks like we're good to continue on. All right. So we're going to talk about the learning profile, but just like with all of us, right, we're all unique individuals. We all have our individual strengths, our individual challenges. Some things come more easily to us than other things, and we are all unique. So this is a learning profile. There are some characteristics that are common in the learning profile of an individual with Down syndrome. So we're going to talk about some of the common characteristics. Excuse me, let me let this someone in. Hello, thank you for joining. Okay, so we're gonna cover communication, literacy, memory, behavior, and we're gonna talk about some of the common characteristics in that learning profile. But again, it's important to just know your student, to understand your student's strengths, your student's challenges, and but it's always helpful to kind of have a, kind of a foundation, right, from which to work. So we're going to talk about communication first, because that's a huge one. So some of the common challenges in communication with individuals with Down syndrome are, there you go, the hypotonia. So what I try to explain to my kiddos in our ability awareness presentations is, you know, how difficult and frustrating it would be to have things you want to say, but not to be able to move your mouth in the way that allows you to articulate the sounds and the words that you want to say. And that's a huge struggle with our kiddos. They have a lot to say. They have a huge receptive, expressive language gap, which means they understand and comprehend a great deal more than they're normally able to articulate verbally. And that's because the hypotonia, those loose and stretchy muscles in their jaws and their tongue and their lips, keep them from being able to just spit out those letter sounds and those vowel sounds and put together their words. And it takes a lot more work. A lot of our kiddos see an oral motor therapist. That's someone who's basically going to the gym for your mouth. You do lots of exercises to try to build up those muscles in your mouth in order to hopefully be able to build up the strength to make those sounds. So as you can imagine, that hypotonia plays a big part in the intelligibility and articulation and expressive language in an individual with Down syndrome. So that's something to consider, and to always, again, just try to remember that, right? As frustrating as it might be to try to interpret what someone with Down syndrome is saying, imagine how frustrating it must be to have something to say and just not always have the right tools to get it out. Hearing and vision challenges will impact communication. Cognitive processing, like I said, Down syndrome is both a cognitive and physical disability. The cognitive processing delays, receiving the message you're sending, decoding it, and then being able to elicit a meaningful response. There are delays in that, and there are sometimes some wires crossed there. So it's always important to remember that as well. Then there are some auditory processing challenges. A lot of our kiddos have some sensory needs and sensory challenges, loud sounds, chaotic, noisy classroom settings, sounds of different electronics or things happening around can really cause some confusion with that auditory processing, which makes communication even more difficult, both receptive and expressive communication. And then we've already talked about the gap. Our kiddos tend to understand a lot more than they can say. So with that, I also want to talk about the strengths of our communicators, of our individuals with Down syndrome and their learning profile. When it comes to communication, our kiddos with Down syndrome are generally very social beings. Now, I do want to, I want us all to keep in mind that if you do have a student who has that dual diagnosis, you have a student who has Down syndrome and may also have autism, then there may be some, you know, social, sorry, just letting someone else in here. Thank you for joining. And so with that, sometimes that can be a challenge as well. If you are working with an individual who doesn't necessarily have that social strength because there's a dual diagnosis there. So it's something to be mindful about. But in general, kiddos with Down syndrome are very social beings. So they're intuitive. They want to use spoken language. Individuals with Down syndrome are some of the most strong-willed individuals I've ever met. They want to participate in the same way you do. They want to belong. They want to be accepted. They want to be a cool kid. And so, of course, they want to use the spoken language. You might hear them kind of babbling or scripting or repeating, but not quite accurately, a show that they've heard or something they've watched over and over again, or something they heard around the classroom by a teacher or a student, etc. The desire is there. They just may not always have the tools to be able to do, to be able to communicate as effectively as they'd like. A lot of our kiddos, almost every person with Down syndrome I've ever met, has an excellent sense of humor. Silliness is a way to their hearts. Being silly, having fun, having a sense of humor, and we can communicate through that strength, absolutely. And higher receptive language, they do understand more than they can say. Some very distinct interests. I'm sure there's at least one or two of you out there who works with a student who really loves something, a character, a TV show, a certain book. And with that, though, that can be a big strength because we can utilize those motivators and those big interests, those distinct interests, to help improve communication or to help, move forward with different steps, etc. Our kiddos do tend to enjoy routine and repetition when they can better understand expectations. They know the next steps. They are more likely to take control of their choices and their next steps, and they're more likely to participate and be more compliant. And so that is a big strength when we know we can utilize repetition as a way to have those students participate more meaningfully. Our kiddos love technology. I don't know many kids who don't, so they're pretty typical in that way. But we will learn more about how we can utilize technology to, again, help engage and instruct our kiddos in meaningful ways to make sure that they're accessing their education. And then this is in bold because it's huge. They are big time visual learners. The more visuals we have available, the more pictures and labels and literacy and picture rich environment, text rich, label rich, picture rich, the more they're going to learn. Huge visual learners, social stories, visual schedules, first then utilizing, PECs or some sort of picture exchange system. These are wonderful ways to reinforce activities, expectations, routines, etc. And by them having that clear visual image that represents, what they're doing or an item they want, etc., we will help build their ability to communicate their ideas, choices, thoughts, needs. And we're going to get a little bit more into that as well and what we have to offer to our educators out there who would like to bring in more visual aids to support your student. Just some general communication strategies. We have what we call the 10-second rule. And I love doing this in my ability awareness presentations because the kiddos really enjoy this. And so I thought, why not do it with my adults as well? we think about how quickly, you know, when we're having a conversation, how quickly we really kind of expect that answer. It's like a tennis match and we're back and forth. Hey, how's your day? Great. How's yours? Oh, not so bad. I'm going to go to the store today. Me too. All right. Have a great one. Bye. Well, all of that took place in about 10 seconds. When you're working with an individual who has a cognitive processing delay, who has to hear what you have to say, decode it, think about a meaningful response, and then figure out how to produce that response, processing time. Second rule, I don't have many teachers and educators who have said this has literally saved my relationship with my student, our ability to communicate. I can't tell you how meaningful just understanding that particular tip has been for my students' education and meaningful participation and connection with other peers in the classroom. So when you are giving a directive to a student with Down syndrome, or you're asking that student a question, wait 10 seconds after doing so to give that student a chance to process what you've said, come up with an answer, and then be able to give you a meaningful response. You'd find it could really make a difference. And that peer making a friend, making a meaningful connection, we want to know what that student is thinking, right? And so by just asking things like a yes or no question, or asking and not really waiting and then moving on to the next student, we're not giving that student a chance to really engage in a way that builds his confidence, that makes him feel like a valuable member of the classroom. And so I think that that's a really great strategy that everyone should, you know, you can take on. It's easy to use and it's great to practice. The other thing, a communication strategy that I know is super effective, is using explicit, concrete, simple, familiar language. For example, if you're giving a general directive to your students, and you're like, all right, everybody, let's wrap this up and get on out to recess. Well, wrap this up and get on out to recess aren't necessarily very concrete ways of letting a student know we're done with this in X number of minutes. And at that point, you need to close your book or finish your activity or put your things in a backpack, push your chair in, stand up, walk with your friends to recess. So keeping in mind to keep things very explicit and not try to use those general terms is a really great strategy for effective communication. Make sure that student understands. You can reinforce with visual aids. So maybe you have a first then chart or a three-step chart. You can reinforce. Okay, Nathan, it's time to put your book in your backpack, then push in your chair, and walk to the door. And we've got three visual aids of him doing those three things. And then he can see that, he's hearing it. We're making good eye contact. You're making sure that you're speaking simply, clearly, and that you are seeing that student is looking at you, receiving the message. You can even ask the student to repeat it if he or she is able to do so, even if it's just with one word or pointing to the picture. And then you just want to make sure that whatever communication needs your student has, that plan is utilized across environments and implemented across environments. If a child is using a high-tech AAC device at school, he should also be using it at home. If a child's using PECS at home, well, we should have some PECS pictures, you know, low-tech communication at school as well. So we want to make sure that there's consistency so that our kiddos can learn how to communicate effectively and consistently across environments throughout the day, in the community, at home, at school. That's very, very important. So as a teacher, an educator, a specialist, it's very important for you to have that clear conversation with the family to understand, how can we come up with a communication system, holistic, that gives your student a voice, your child a voice, and tech devices, gesture, verbal approximations. And forgive me here, I just got a message that says my connection's unstable. So if you see anything that looks unstable, you can give me a sign and I can't really tell on my end. So again, we just want to make sure that the communication strategies that we're using is utilized across environments. So not being able to speak is not the same as not having something to say. We all need to communicate. I can't imagine what it would be like to not be able to express myself. And if we're not recognizing that as a key issue, as a key piece of successful education, then we're missing the mark here. There's no way a student is going to be able to succeed in school, to succeed socially, to master any type of subject, to be able to participate in extracurricular activities, make new friends, navigate his day-to-day at life without a means to communicate. So communication is seriously at the top of our priority list here. And there are lots of ways people can communicate. And it's about working with your families and families working with your education team to develop a holistic and effective communication system. We're going to talk a little bit about that now. So multimodal communication. Basically, no one has to communicate in just one way. We may have kids that have 50 or 100 words under their belt. They can verbalize. They can maybe use one or two, put one or two words together for, you know, to help build a sentence. But that's not always enough. You can't always express, you know, deeper feelings or ideas or thoughts when you have limited expressive language abilities. And so that's when we want to look and say, okay, how can we build on that? How can we increase their language? And so we want to make sure that we're giving them an opportunity to communicate in lots of different ways. There are, you know, obviously there's auditory communication. We can use our bodies with gestures and signs. We can use visual we can use visual aids to help as well, written schedules or written aids to help as well. There are some examples of how we can incorporate different types of communication in order to help students participate more meaningfully. For example, for a kiddo who has a hard time coming up with ideas on the spot or recalling what happened, let's say you're at circle time and it's Monday and everyone is sharing what they did over the weekend. Well, for a kiddo with a cognitive processing delay and with expressive speech challenges, then it's going to be harder for that kiddo to be able to come up with a response right on the fly. Not to mention our kiddos have fear of failure and anxiety. A lot of times there may not be relatability. They understand that some other students may not want to wait for their answers. They understand that they aren't able to express themselves as well and clearly as their peers. And so we want to make sure that we're providing them with an opportunity to still have a voice and not let that disability get in the way of it. So maybe you have a speech generating device at circle time that you've already pre-programmed so that that student can, from maybe mom or a peer or teacher, already programmed in what happened over the weekend. So that student can push a button and share with the classroom still. Or maybe you have a device that has today's date or Wednesday, you've had the thing Wednesday, February 3rd, 2021, and that's already on there. And you know that on Wednesday, Samuel is going to be participating in circle time because he's going to be the date guy, right? So you can use those types of communication devices to help your student access participation, meaningful participation. You can use visual cues, instructions. You can create communication and systems boards. And we're going to go more into that because we've got some great resources on our website to help you with that. And then also make sure that you accept and include gestural communication. We can do a lot of communicating without opening our mouths. Yes, no, we can make faces to show that we're sad or happy or excited. We can use thumbs up, thumbs down. We can wave to say hi. So make sure that if we're seeing that attempt and we're seeing that someone's trying to communicate, we're recognizing that and we're praising it. And then we can help that student build upon that. So when we talk about building upon, there are two ways we can do that. And I kind of, what I'd like to do is really switch these around. We've got AT, which is assistive technology, and we've got AAC, which is alternative and augmentative communication. So what AT is, assistive technology, that's the systems and different tools put in place to help the functioning of an individual with a disability. So we talked about those loose and stretchy muscles, the hypotonia. I know my colleague and self-advocate Eli, who I said is 23 years old, and admittedly, and he admits and his mom admits, writing is not his strength. That hypotonia has always impacted his ability to be able to write legibly, to form letters, and to be able to, you know, express himself through writing, because writing itself is an OT skill. It's not really an academic skill. It doesn't mean he doesn't know what he wants to write. The physical disability keeps him from being able to do so effectively without pain, frustration, which then may result in behavior. So instead, with access to assistive technology, he's able to use a device to be able to express himself. He's able to access technology in order to better understand the lesson that's being taught, because it's presented to him in a way that is more meaningful or that works with his learning style. And so having that assistive technology is very important for many of our kiddos. The writing piece is one of the big ones that I can come up with. I always tell my families, I always tell my education teams to remember that writing is an OT goal, but the inability to form letters should never impact your ability to participate alongside typically developing students. If there's an expressive writing activity, then that student should be able to access the means to express himself through differentiated ways and differentiated means of expression. He can always still work toward an OT goal, but that should never impact his participation in, alongside typical peers. That's his disability. So then I want to talk more then about AAC, because we're kind of piggybacking on communication here. So AAC, alternative, that means different. So if I'm not speaking using my words, I have to find a different way to communicate. And augmentative, so that's adding to. So when we're augmenting something, we are making it more robust. We're adding to it, making it greater. So like I said, if you've got that student that has 50 words in its word bank and he's working with a speech therapist and they're continuing to build, that doesn't mean that those 50 words are the only thing that he's going to be able to use in order to express himself. We need to build on that. We need to make it greater, maybe through alternative means of expression. So what we do with that is we've got lots of different types of AAC. So let's take a look at that. So AAC can mean no tech, and I love this, using your own devices. So that just means when you can use your body to make gestures. So if I'm not talking with you using my voice and my words, then I can communicate with you through those gestural prompts like I told you about. So whether it's sign language or again, thumbs up, thumbs down, stop, no, you know, all of those things, right? You are communicating, but that's using no tech. Then there is low tech. There's no power source. You just have access to pictures and labels that help that visual learner be able to make choices, be able to communicate needs, be able to see and understand and execute expectations or routine or schedule. And so those are easy to access. You can, you know, we've got PECs for days that you can use in any kind of situation, in the community, at the grocery store, at the library, at a birthday party, in school, throughout different environments, at recess, lunch, you know, in the classroom. And, you know, there are tons and tons of resources out there for PECs. And I'm going to show you what we have available in our library. But before I do that, we also have the Light Tech. You heard me talk about that speech generating device or something that you can. It's battery operated, you know, pretty easy to maneuver. It's user friendly, where you might have a GoTalk that just has four selections with pre-recorded, you know, smile, cat, ball. And then there here is a step-by-step. Is that what it's called? I forgot the name. I think it's step by step, where you can pre-record, like I talked about sharing at circle time, and you've got that recording there. You just push a button and it generates a phrase or an answer, and it's already pre-recorded. Again, just a great way to help a kiddo express himself, communicate, and participate at times when maybe it's harder to just come up with the language on the spot. And then finally, there's HiTech AAC, and that's something that is highly customizable, programmable. It's on an iPad or some sort of tablet, and that student uses that as a communication tool. So there are lots of different preset programs, again, fully customized, and they can really use it right there on that screen in order to you know, communicate their needs, express their feelings, their ideas, make choices, etc. And you can really build the language with that one, putting things together. So obviously we go from, you know, no tech to very high tech, which has, you know, is a bit more complicated and customized. And there's kind of you know, moving from the first, you know, into the low tech and light tech and high tech, it kind of progresses in that way. Once you become familiar, a kiddo becomes familiar with using PECs, knowing that they can use these symbols and these words to communicate, then they'll be more familiar, you know, if it is time to use an AAC device, they'll have more familiarity with just what that looks like, but now it's on a touch screen. And not every student with Down syndrome needs an AAC device. We have a lot of students who have great intelligibility, who are able to express their needs and don't end up needing that high tech device in order to communicate effectively. However, most of our kiddos and students still really benefit from those low tech prompts. Just as visual reminders, again, because they're high visual learners, just to kind of be able to see and plan, make choices, so that it's not kind of abstractly floating around in their head. They can communicate it, but they might still need that support and for you to elicit more meaningful responses. So I want to talk with you guys about AAC. If teachers, you guys are absolutely welcome to observe your student and make a recommendation, have a candid discussion with your families if you feel that your student's communication challenges are impeding his or her ability to participate meaningfully in class. Are they missing those opportunities to communicate? Are they having big breakdowns? Are you seeing big behaviors because it seems that student is not able to participate meaningfully? Those are all signs that it might be, you know, and especially as our kiddos are getting a little older and we're seeing, you know, the speech just isn't coming along as quickly as probably that student wants it to. And how can we support? Again, always thinking about that holistic picture, that multimodal communication. What all can we do for this student to help support whole child communication? And so if you understand, you know, you're seeing that there's a huge gap in that expressive and receptive language. If you're seeing that that student is not participating meaningfully, if you're seeing those breakdowns, you're more than welcome to have a discussion with the family and family members. For those of you who are parents joining us today, you're very welcome to have that discussion with your education team. There's nothing wrong with starting the discussion. And from there, you can request an AAC evaluation, just like any evaluation through the district. They've got specialists trained in AAC. They're normally speech and language pathologists. And then they can provide, you know, at that point, if the SLP or AAC specialist deems it necessary to have an AAC device, the district can you know, provide those training hours. We write it into the IEP, and then there's some accountability there. Then we have some goals. And again, now we've got a system and a plan, a communication plan that we can use in the school environment, and that needs to come back into the home environment as well, because we have to have that continuity and consistency in order to make our kiddos better communicators from a holistic standpoint. So I want to talk a little bit about our low-tech communications library. This is something that's very new on our website, and I'm going to attempt here to navigate our website while I've got you guys here. Okay, and I'm going to take you to Down Syndrome Connections homepage. Actually, it's the education page where I live. But once you Google dscba.org, you can go right here to the education page and DESEA, that's me and us. And you can see here, we've got lots of different resources, but I'm gonna bring us down here to AAC, Augmentative Alternative Communication. If you click on that, our AAC specialists and SLPs have worked very hard to create this wonderful low-tech library. And what it is it is basically a full library of tons of low-tech communication tools that also include a whole bunch of icons you can click on. So if you see here, I'm over here, how to use this library. So it has downloadable communication boards that you can do, you know, via PDF, and then helpful links you can click on. So that pertain to that particular topic or the thing that, you know, is in that particular board. So there might be videos that you can watch or that are engaging for your student. There may be a website with helpful information that goes a little bit more into a specific topic or strategy. There are songs that are interactive that you can work, you know, sing with your kiddo or play for your kiddo during instruction. And so they're really rich in content. And then on top of that, if you have BoardMaker, a lot of parents at home don't have BoardMaker, but a lot of schools have access to BoardMaker. If you have BoardMaker, you can actually just click on this BoardMaker online link and you can customize it yourself. But let me just give you some topics. So we've got core boards with core words, and you can see here, we've got all of these different videos on different, again, communication tools explained. Here's some books and videos, learning with Mr. Clay, core vocabulary activities. And you can see here, we've got, you know, some core ideas and concepts using our picture exchanges. And we also have it in Spanish. So for any of our Spanish speaking families, or if you are a teacher working with Spanish speaking family, you can introduce these core boards to at school, but also to families at home. And this is something that they can use at home with their kiddos as well. So we're really proud of that. We brought on a gal who's really helped us with bringing all of our materials in Spanish. And we hope that everything at some point will be available in Spanish as well. Now, if you do not have BoardMaker and you are a parent or a teacher who would like to customize a particular thing, maybe you want to use different pictures, maybe you want to use something a lot more customizable as far as specific food, right? If your kiddo likes a very specific food or wants something very, uses something very specific, then you can actually contact us. You can fill out a form, and we've got that up here. Let's see if I can, it's hard to navigate why. Let me see if I got the form here. So go back one. Do you see here it says personalize your board, submit your form here. So if there's a particular topic, schedule, behavioral, you know, token, economy chart, a routine, there's tons of stuff on here. Math, not only academics, we've got icons for math and literacy. We've got visual schedules. We also have the different social events and recess and birthdays and holidays. So we have access to all kinds of these low tech materials, as well as the helpful links. And it looks like a lot, but actually each section, it follows the same format. Now we have an entire workshop only on using this low tech library. And you can find, let me just show you, whoops. Sorry, I got in the wrong spot. Share screen. Go back here. You can find these things. Sorry, this thing makes it hard to navigate sometimes. Okay. So I just wanted to show you, since I'm online here, if you get back to my education homepage, Down Syndrome Educational Alliance, and you scroll down, you will see our Teach Workshop series. The PDF presentations are available on all 13 workshops we've done. As you can see here, we have one on Numicon, which is a math approach we'll talk about a little bit later, effective teaching strategies for individuals with Down syndrome, homework modifications, behavior, communication, IEPs, sensory, social skills, school readiness, so on and so on. And so with that, please feel free to come to our webpage, come to our website, and look at all these resources we have for you. There's tons of stuff here. And if you ever have any questions about navigating it or need just a little extra support, we're here to help. I know that that's a lot to cover. Like I said, we've got full workshops on each of these subjects. So just trying to highlight the main points so that you know what resources are available to you through our website. Okay, so with that, let's get back to our presentation. And let me just pause for 1 second because it looks like we have chat and I just want to make sure. Oh, the sound glitches. Thanks for letting me know. Okay. Okay, so literacy. So research shows that kiddos with Down syndrome can begin to read at a young age. They tend to be very visual readers, and a lot of times they learn phonics later than their typical peers. That being said, they can learn to read in the absence of the phonological awareness. We have a lot of our kiddos, again, because of that strong visual memory, they tend to be masters at sight word, flashcards, reading content, and even, you know, eventually work into being able to decode those words and practice that phonological process. But it really takes a little bit longer. So be patient with that. Some of our kiddos have, a lot of our kiddos have apraxia, and there can be, you know, some challenges with identifying those letter sounds and being consistent with that. There are specialized literacy programs out there, and we're going to tell you about a few of them that have proven to show improvements in reading and language development. See and Learn was developed specifically for kiddos with Down syndrome. We offer See and Learn to loan out to schools. Our loaner kits are for 3 months, so you can actually check it out of our lending library. You can try it out, see what you think about it, with no, you know, it doesn't, you know, there's no cost to you. If it works, great. But we do have those materials to loan you to, you know, to help whatever we can do so that you can help your kiddo access his education. So we have See and Learn. There's the Reading and Language Intervention Program, Special Reads for Special Needs. I'm not sure if you have heard of Natalie Hale and her Special Reads Program. It's fantastic. She actually came and did a presentation with us earlier this year. She is part of our family. We'd like to consider her as part of our family. And she has an excellent program for reading and the learning program. Those are all, there was a new one. I can't remember it right now. Shoot. My colleague's been using with her son and she really loves it. I'm going to have to add it to here. And if I can think of that, I'll send it out to you guys, or if I can get that from her. There are lots of different programs out there, but there are some that are more evidence-based and that we've seen, you know, lots of success specifically with the learning profile of someone with Down syndrome. Some strategies you can use is make sure that you're utilizing any communication system you have with that student, creating an organized and familiar language environment, just making sure that, again, we're keeping things simple and explicit, and then implementing activities that can improve sound discrimination, phonological awareness. I can't tell you enough how helpful it is to incorporate learning, incorporate songs into learning. Our kiddos do a really great job. They love music. Most of our kiddos are huge fans of music, movement to music, dancing, drama, et cetera. We talked about the strength of having a great sense of humor. We talked about, you know, silliness. And so really utilizing those strengths and motivators to incorporate, you know, some of these literacy activities to help keep them motivated while engaging in, you know, with their strengths. So memory, that's something that is important to note as a teacher, because there are some challenges there. I've been working and providing supplemental academic support to individuals with Down syndrome for years. And, you know, I can work with a kiddo and we're doing Numicon and he's mastering these certain skills. And then the next day I see him and it's like that all went out the window. And so it's interesting because individuals with Down syndrome have a very impressive memory for areas of high interest. My colleague Eli, you've heard me mention a lot. He knows about everything there is to know about music and especially rock and roll music. He loves rock and roll. If I asked him what was AC/DC's number one hit in 1984 in June, he would be able to tell me what the song was. He has a really impressive memory, kind of a Rolodex, encyclopedic memory of rock and roll music and history. However, you know, he may show more inconsistencies in things that are less impactful on him, things that are less meaningful to him. Another strength is our individuals are great with, good with routines. We've already talked about that, right? So understanding expectations, utilizing that visual aid to reinforce those expectations, and being able to depend on a routine is not only helpful for our individuals, their memory, but also it's a great way to build independence which we definitely want to do. So because they're strong visual learners, they have a strong visual memory. And so having those routines in place, utilizing high motivators are great ways to build on memory strengths. Again, some of the challenges is when you have auditory processing deficits, if you have rules and routines, you know, like most kids, those are so much harder to learn than things about your favorite subject, right? And so having a visual of expectations up, right, of a routine, of a house rule or a classroom rule, that's going to help so that we're not just depending on that memory, working memory to have it all right there in the banks. Developing those organizational skills, that is a big challenge, which is again why the visuals are huge. Integrating new knowledge can sometimes be difficult, so we really have to be consistent with it, reintroducing it over and over and over again. And we'll talk a little bit more about that. Understanding of, you know, like an abstract concept. So math is always going to be, is generally a bit more difficult because math's pretty abstract. Telling time, that's pretty abstract concept. It takes a little more time to understand and, remembering like day-to-day skills. So like I said, like math facts, right? Sometimes with the working memory, those things are just a little too abstract and need a extra push, more consistency and reintroducing those skills basically on a daily basis. So some different interventions that you can use. You can do memory games, read aloud or listen to audiobooks. Books are great. Our kiddos and students that I work with can really get into a book. And if they're having difficulty reading them on their own, audiobooks are a great way to help work on, you know, targeted memory activities. Implementing a structured reading program like See and Learn, something that we know works with the learning profile of an individual with Down syndrome, is very helpful. Really checking and rechecking those comprehension and retention skills. We talk about repetition. It's so important for our kiddos. It's so important for our students. You see here, we say 7 times is a charm. And, you know, that's at least 7 times. So what seems like, you know, oh gosh, we just went through this. No, you probably need to go through it 6 more times. Then just to be able to, you may have to go through it 6 more times just to get, you know, just to establish that foundation and that understanding. And then you probably got to go through it again the next day. So just remembering that it's super important, repetition, consistency, continuity. Again, use those visual aids. We can't say it enough. It makes a big difference. Behavior. Well, again, we have an entire workshop on behavior. But behavior is something that we see across environments from every kiddo, right? It's not just kiddos with Down syndrome. That being said, I know that when I work with teachers and parents at home who are participating in a virtual learning environment, they're about to pull their hair out because we're getting some behaviors. And I think that it's important to start in a place of empathy and understand that, you know, behaviors happen in every kiddo, right? All kids misbehave, all students misbehave, but remember that behavior serves a function. So it's important to really understand what that child or student is trying to, the function of the behavior, what that student's trying to achieve, right? Why is that behavior taking place? It's not necessarily just because that kiddo wants, you know, to to be the bad guy at school, right? Because that person wants to inflict harm on someone or just wants to give the teacher a hard time. Behavior occurs for a reason. So it's important to make sure that you do your best to identify the function and not just jump to a conclusion. Now, what we can do is once we've identified a function, so let's say, for example, we finish lunch, or let's say we finish recess, and one of those things, lunch or recess, and that is your student's favorite time of the day. Loves to eat, loves to get out and play and kick a ball or swing on a swing, and then it's time to transition into math. And you transition into math, and that student's expected to sit down at a desk and take a look at a worksheet that has a whole bunch of problems on it. And it's one dimensional, and it's in black and white, and the font is small. And as soon as the kid gets to his desk and he sees the worksheet, he starts to engage in certain behaviors. Maybe he clears the desk when he comes and sits down. Maybe he hides under the desk. Maybe he turns the computer screen around in a virtual learning environment or runs away into the next room. Maybe when he runs away into the next room, the kids laugh and he looks back and he runs away again. So we need to figure out, what's the function here? Is the function that the student is maybe, about to do some work that's non-preferred, or maybe the demand is inappropriate? Maybe that worksheet should have been modified so that there are only 4 problems on it in a large font, and he has manipulatives next to the worksheet so that he can work in real time and understand, make it more meaningful for him to be able to handle the problems. Maybe he needs extra time to handle them, or a different space that's less noisy or chaotic. Or maybe he saw that the first time and ran away, but when he heard the kids laughing, he was getting attention for it. And so now it doesn't matter what the work is. If the kids laugh every time he gets up and runs to the other room and he looks back and sees them doing that, he's repeating that behavior, right? So there are 2 different functions there. So it's important to start to see consistencies, understanding what happened right before the behavior occurred, observing and noting what the behavior was, and then understanding what happened after that, right? So understanding what the consequence of that behavior was. Did he see the math worksheet? It was too hard. He ran away, and then he got to go take a break with mom in the other room while the rest of the kids did their math. Well, hey, he's probably not going to do that math worksheet anymore because he got to escape and avoid the thing that was hard for him, right? Or if the kids laugh and then he comes back and he sits at the desk and they say, oh, you're, so silly, and nothing happens with that, right? He's going to continue that behavior. So it's important to understand what happened before, what the behavior is, and what's happening afterward in order to understand the function. And once you understand the function, you can start to replace the behavior with something more appropriate. So if he sees the math worksheet and that is, it has a lot of problems on it, and instead of clearing the table or running away, he's got a card that says, I need help. Or he has a card, a visual that says, I need a break. Maybe a feelings card there, right? Giving him an opportunity to express himself prior to any kind of big behavior happening. So once we identify the function, we can identify a replacement behavior that serves the same purpose, gives him the same, is fulfilling the same need and the function, but it's more appropriate, which in turn is going to build his self-confidence and his independence in order to make more appropriate choices as he navigates his day-to-day environment. the main functions of behavior that we see most of the time are sensory. So he may need to meet a sensory need. A lot of our kiddos can become quite dysregulated, tired and worn out. We see a lot of hints in their behavior. You might start hear some stimming or seeing some of those activities, some rocking, maybe a little like, kind of like, we've called it with a couple of kiddos, just like sleepy talk, stimming, I'm tired, I don't know, I'm getting super tired. You may start to see, you know, more dysregulated, you know, getting up and running out. You know, it may just mean that he needs to take a 2-minute break on a little trampoline or with some therapy prior to a writing activity. So if it's a sensory need, we can identify that and then provide that kiddo with either a break or a sensory activity to help him regulate to be prepared for the activity. Escape, right? So they just want to escape from a certain task, environment, something non-preferred. There's attention, right? From peers or adults, and that attention can be positive or negative. Even when you're yelling at someone, don't run, don't run. They're just hearing, run, run, run. And especially if you're saying their name, Joshua, no running. Joshua, don't run. Well, that's just a game. Right. So instead, think about using more explicit language like, Joshua, show me walking feet, and model walking feet. Then he's hearing the expectation more than hearing, don't do that. Right. And then when you see walking feet, you can proactively praise Joshua for using his walking feet. I like that Joshua has good walking feet. Give me a virtual fist bump. You know, a Zoom fist pump, I don't know. Now then we are bringing attention to and rewarding those appropriate behaviors. So always look out for those things kind of. And a lot of the times I tell families, look for things when nothing's happening, right? So don't wait until our kiddos are engaging in that negative behavior. Be mindful of when they are not, when they're engaging in inappropriate behaviors, and then reinforce those with a lot of positive praise. And then the other is tangible, right? They might desire a specific item, person, or activity. Again, when we have kids with significant communication challenges, if they are able to then kind of try again and request the item that they need, whether it's, you know, a specific toy they'd like to hold while they're doing an activity, or maybe it's a person, you know, I need 5 minutes with mom. Maybe it's a break so that they can, you know, do a couple of gorilla jumps and just kind of get their bodies re-regulated, giving them the tools to communicate those needs, right? That would be an appropriate replacement. You can start to then negotiate, right? So we can negotiate for more time now because you're using your words instead of running away. So helping your student find that replacement activity, action or behavior that is appropriate, that we can praise and we can reinforce through proactive positive praise is the good way to go. So we talked about the antecedent, the behavior, and the consequence. The antecedent being the thing that happens right before the behavior, what the behavior is, and what happened afterwards. So for our kiddos with Down syndrome, some of the strengths in behavior is that they really do enjoy social relationships. They enjoy making friends. They like to watch their peers. A lot of them liked to imitate what their peers are modeling. They have great receptive language skills so they can understand what's going on around them. They do enjoy their independence. They wanna work toward their independence, and we wanna help foster that, which is why we help model and teach them the more appropriate behaviors that help them navigate effectively and appropriately in these environments. And again, great sense of humor. That's definitely a strength when it comes to behavior. A lot of times just a little silly redirection goes a long way. If a kiddo throws himself to the floor because he doesn't feel like going to the bathroom yet, give him a choice. Maybe he can, you know, hop like a bunny rabbit to the bathroom, or slide like, you know, slide like an ice skater. Think about that student's motivators, those interests, and try to come up with some creative and silly ways of redirecting so that you're avoiding that useless power struggle. Some challenges, our kiddos can be non-compliant. If they do not want to do something, they may avoid challenging tasks. They can withdraw social. Etc. that come out, and they'll go at a slower pace, which is a challenge sometimes when you've got time parameters and you need to get from point A to point B in a transition, etc. But again, thinking about those motivators, using some silly creative redirection goes a long way. So behavior is communication. We think about this. I feel like I duplicated this. Yeah, I did. Let's go to that one. Sometimes, you know, if you're not able to express your needs or your wants, your ideas in any other way, you're going to use behavior. So if we haven't established that holistic communications plan, then our kids are going to engage in behaviors to communicate with us, which is why we spent so much time on communication, because it's imperative. They need that ability to communicate effectively and appropriately, or else we will see behavior. If the work or the demand is inappropriate, we have students who are, and we have quite a few students who work in both, you know, special ed education environments and also in general education environments. And I've got a lot of students who are fully included in general education. It does not mean they have to be working at the same grade level as their peers, but sometimes they're getting grade level work and it's not being modified appropriately and tailored to their IEP goals. And with that, then if our kiddos are feeling overwhelmed, they have that fear of failure, the demand is just too great and it's overwhelming, we're gonna see some behaviors related to that. As a matter of fact, in my work with different various school districts, education teams, families, IEP teams, when a behaviorist has to come in, and the behaviorist does observations, ends up creating a behavior intervention plan, or maybe even goes into, you know, a functional behavioral analysis and does the full FBA. I find 90% of the time, the two functions of behavior are communication and demand, inappropriate demand. That's when we see the biggest behaviors come out of our kiddos, when they don't have the ability to communicate and when the demand that's placed on them is not appropriate to where they are, they're learning. So just keep that in mind. Those are two biggies. If they're not given enough processing time, if you don't give them that 10 seconds to elicit a meaningful response, they may get frustrated, embarrassed, aggravated with that they can't express themselves effectively. We're going to see behavior with that. And kind of like all of us, if the topic is not interesting or meaningful, or even worse, if they're not being engaged, right, to participate, if they don't feel like a valued member of the classroom, a valued member among this group who can actually participate in meaningful ways and give you, you know, be able to raise their hand and respond appropriately, answer questions, be involved, then you're going to see some behaviors with that as well. We all want to feel like meaningful participants in a classroom setting, whether that's virtual or on site. So prevention, that is the priority. If we can ensure that our students have an effective communication system, that's going to do a lot of good. Use visuals, can't say it enough. Offer non-contingent praise. You know, our kiddos love to be the center of attention. And by offering praise, proactive, positive praise when we're seeing those behaviors, you know, when things are calm, when they are engaging in appropriate behaviors, that goes a long way. It's breaking our tasks into smaller, manageable steps. That's a big one. A lot of our students may have difficulty following multi-step instructions. It can get pretty confusing, especially if you're not using a visual aid. And so make sure that the demand you're putting on them, if it's multi-step instructions, that you are just using, you know, that you're putting them in manageable chunks so that they can address each task separately, succeed with that one, and move forward. That's going to build their confidence and their self-efficacy. Peer collaboration goes a long way. Just having that peer support, feeling included, having a peer, you know, have your back, those are always really important. First then, that's a great reinforcer, especially with some of our younger students, seeing what the expectation is and then a nice big reward for that for achieving that expectation. First then is a great starter, kind of pre-specify reinforcer. First do this and then we can do this. It's a great starter kind of behavioral strategy. And allow alternatives, right? So if they need a break, give them the means to be able to request one. If they start to identify those problem feelings and they have the ability to ask for a break, then make sure that we're working with them and showing them that we hear them and that that they are being heard, and because they are using appropriate means to communicate their needs, we're willing to accommodate them. If a system's working, think before fading it. Like we talked about, repetition. If it's working, don't be too, you know, quick to say, oh, great, we're good to go, and now we don't need this anymore. Try to stick with it, because like I said, our kiddos, our students really rely on routine and repetition. And so that might be the thing that's actually really keeping things in place. So don't necessarily just fade out of something, especially if it's working. So just some key strategies for disruptive behaviors. Make sure that there aren't any medical issues. Remember, we always start with health first. Our students have, some of them have significant health challenges. And we just want to make sure that we are, again, coming from that place of empathy and saying, yeah, you know, I understand there are a lot of health challenges that come with having Down syndrome, not to mention the physical and cognitive disability. Let's make sure there's nothing going on here, you know, that we can't address from a health perspective. Don't give big reactions. I always say ignore safe attention-seeking behaviors. If it's just to get your attention, it might be just dropping something on the floor and they're looking for a reaction. You know, I just try to move on. And then later, you know, I might give a directive as far as, you know, picking that up, picking something up, or even a choice. Say they dropped 3 crayons on the floor. Do you want to pick up the red crayon or the blue crayon? Giving some choices to empower them with choice, feel a part of the cleanup. You know, they get to experience being, you know, helpful, and they'll get lots of positive praise for being helpful by cleaning up, but I'm not bringing attention to the dropping. I'm just going to ignore it. And then they're going to get positive praise for, again, those appropriate behaviors. Try to refrain from the big, strong emotions and realize that there's a lot going on. The bigger and stronger our reaction is, the more reinforcement we're going to be giving them, and you're probably going to see that behavior repeated. Pick and choose your battles for sure. Our kiddos and students will test you, and they're very, very strong-willed. So utilizing things like a timer, giving them an opportunity to ask for more time. One strategy that I always use is if I've got, you know, let's say 10 minutes to spare, I see that one of my students is asking for more time or has had a great time, you know, doing the activity, let's just say we've got 5 minutes to spare. Let's say we're in a, you know, situation at school and you don't have that much transition time. If they say, I want more time, I'll say, great. Thank you so much for asking. Or let's say they, you know, throw a fit because it's time to transition. I will give them, I will add on that extra 5 minutes so they don't know that there's actually 5 minutes left. And I'll say, we're wrapping up the activity in 1 minute. I can see you're having a lot of fun. If you need more time, don't forget to use your words or your pictures or whatever communication tool they have to let me know. And sometimes they might throw a fit and then I'll have them try again to ask for more time. When they ask for more, I automatically will set that timer for another minute. And then when the timer goes off again, I will have them, you know, if they are able to ask for more time, if they remember that that's a strategy they can use to negotiate for more time, it's appropriate, they're using their words and they're requesting, then I will reward them again. So we're helping diffuse that power struggle. And then at the same time, we're also empowering our students with a voice. They can negotiate. They are being heard. By using their words, they're being appropriate and they're being rewarded for it. So that's another strategy that I use as far as kind of the pick your battles thing and avoiding big power struggles. We have more of those types of strategies on our behavior, in our behavior presentation that I showed you on our DSEA page, but those are just some ideas that I use a lot, some strategies. Giving the student a job, that is a huge one. They can ring the bell, they can put sanitizer on their peers' hands, they can choose a student, buddy up with a peer, pass out books, carry, do some heavy work, push in chairs, carry books over, anything that makes that student feel like a productive member of the classroom, a valued member of the classroom, keeping that child actively participating in the classroom setting or in a virtual setting. Think about some creative jobs you can give that student. It makes them feel better. And also, if there is heavy work to do, then we're also helping that kiddo stay regulated. And so just some things to keep in mind. Big helper roles really go well with our kiddos. They love to be recognized as helpful, valuable members of the classroom. Social stories are always great to help prepare our kiddos about what's going on, especially if there's going to be a change happening, if it's a new or novel experience, having a social story about it. If you can create a customized social story with pictures of your student participating in this particular activity, or if it's a behavior, or if it's a routine, or you know, any type of recess or lunch, a social story about what's expected. That's a great way for that kiddo to see him or herself as the star of the story. And the more they see visually and read what those expectations are, the more likely they are to imitate that, to remember that, to execute those same actions and behaviors. And we just have some examples of some charts that you can use. We've got those on our low-tech communications library. We have some different behavioral charts as well, different social stories so that this person can plan for the steps. This person knows that he needs to be quiet at the library, what he does at the library, how he can ask for help, etc. And so understanding that routine through visuals. And again, if you can customize it with real life pictures, that's even better. Stimming, we'll just touch on this. You heard me talk earlier about some of the stimming behaviors we see in our kiddos with Down syndrome. This is a self-regulation strategy. And so a lot of times, you know, we respectfully ask that you ignore stimming unless it becomes super destructive or disruptive, if it's impeding their development in some way. In general, it's just a way for our kiddos may not even know that they're doing it. It's just a self-regulation strategy. We do things, you know, all the time without even realizing. I'm sitting here kind of rocking in my chair, moving around. I've moved my fingers along this desk, and I'm constantly kind of doing things and tapping things that help me self-regulate. And it's no different with our kiddos with Down syndrome, except sometimes it may be a little more obvious. And some kids around may wonder, what's going on? Why is he making that noise? Or why is he repeating that behavior? So I think it's just important to be aware of it, to not bring too much attention to it, and to just understand that it does help recenter that emotional equilibrium. It does encourage their self-awareness. And we just want to just be mindful that it's a pretty natural thing for our kids. And there's some examples down here about what stimming can look like. And again, if it does get super loud, disruptive, if you feel like it's impeding your student's development, then we have to look into, you know, maybe some alternative ways of getting that same feedback without disrupting other students or you know, making a big impact, developmental impact on the student. Young children, you know, early intervention, right? It exists for a reason, because all kiddos are sponges. Those first 5 to 7 years are super, super important. So when it comes to kiddos with Down syndrome, it's no different. This is my friend Avery here, who got started very young, at a young age, learning to read and socializing with her peers and being in different environments. And she's thriving. She is a really meaningful, valued member of her classroom. She participates in her talent shows at school and all of the social activities. She's been on HBO and a couple of movies. She's a real go-getter, but that's because her mom and dad really pushed her into lots of different environments and encouraged her learning at a very early age. And we can do the same with all children with Down syndrome. Like with every kiddo, you know, making sure we have those opportunities. We create a literacy rich environment for them in an early age, introduce them to lots of different environments and sensory experiences. And embedding learning through play, imaginative play, and things that are fun and motivating, and making sure that we're incorporating multi-sensory learning experiences. None of us love to just learn by looking at something and reading it and that's it, right? We want real life experiences. We want to attach them to meaningful things in our lives. And so that's how we should approach learning for our individuals with Down syndrome who learn a bit differently. They need physical learning. They need visual learning, auditory learning. Actually, all of our kids do, really. We all do. We all have our different intelligences. And so just making sure we're introducing our young kiddos to a variety of learning experiences from a young age is super, super important. And like it says here at the bottom, have fun. And that is true, because our kiddos love to have fun. All right. Potty training. I'm not going to go through a whole ton of this. We actually have a whole potty training webinar coming up within the next couple of months, but it's just important to recognize as an educator that it's okay if your student seems like he or she should be potty trained at this point and he or she is not potty trained. Because of that low muscle tone, there's a lot of the developmental readiness is not always there. There are some sensory issues. Sometimes we feel things too much. Sometimes we don't feel things, that readiness, that feeling isn't there. And so it does take some time. It's important to look for signs of readiness and try to begin the process, but it involves good communication with the school team, the para, the family at home, and just make sure everyone has the same idea. And the most important thing is just be patient. All of our kiddos, generally, for the most part, will potty train, will become independent with their toileting routine. It just takes a little extra time. And it does say caution, bathroom may be overused as an escape or a break. Always good to be mindful about the function of wanting to go potty. Just touching on this, if you're working with adolescents, just keep in mind that precocious puberty is the real thing and that hormones can be rampant. Make sure that you're having an open discussion about it. Talk with your families. We want to make sure that our adolescents are getting the education that they need in order to be appropriate in, public and private settings. Sometimes reading social cues and kind of knowing when to stop, like with hugs, for example, or making contact with physical contact, those things can sometimes, with that cognitive processing, can take a little more time. So it's important to hold our adolescents with Down syndrome to high expectations by just helping them understand and educating them about what is appropriate. Make sure that we don't just say, they've got Down syndrome, so they're just gonna be, no. It's important to hold them to high expectations. We wanna make sure that they know how to navigate their community appropriately, just like we're all expected to. Inclusive education. We're all about inclusive education here because evidence supports that inclusive education is the right way to go. We know that kids who are with disabilities who are educated alongside typically developing peers have higher outcomes, both with job, secondary education, their social life, finding work, meaningful work. And we also know that typical students who are educated alongside disabled peers have more empathy. They're less likely to bully. They're more likely to get community-related, service-related jobs. And so all in all, inclusive education works for everybody. When we think about it, when our kiddos go through school and they're getting out into the real world, we don't have a special segregated place for students for people with disabilities, a segregated grocery store, segregated library, post office, or shopping mall. We're all expected to navigate this real world together. And so the more we can bring students of all abilities together in the same environment, the more we're all going to learn from one another, and we'll be able to navigate the real world with some confidence, a sense of belonging. And so I think that at the end of the day, it's just the right thing to do. And it's important as educators that you guys remember, inclusion does not mean that you as educators are responsible for keeping or getting your students with Down syndrome to grade level standards. A student with Down syndrome can be educated alongside typical peers in a general classroom setting and does not have to be doing the same grade level work. Now, this is something, again, whole other workshop, but this is something you want to talk with your family about, especially depending on the age of the child. Once the student is in high school, a freshman in high school, the family and the education team needs to decide whether that student's going to be on typical diploma track. And at that point, we'll be responsible for achieving all the same grade level standards. But until that time, because that student has an IEP, and individualized goals, that student can absolutely participate in a general education placement setting and not be doing the same work as his peers. And if there are any teachers out there who have any questions or concerns regarding that, because I've talked with a lot, especially general education teachers who feel like they've been failing their students, they don't know how to grade them, they don't know how to necessarily who's modifying work, how they're modifying it, is it appropriate? And these are all questions that really should be addressed in IEP meetings, but unfortunately, they often get kind of overlooked. And so if you do, as an educator, have questions like that, please don't hesitate to come to me, and I'd be more than happy to work with you, the education team, your family, bridging any of those gaps in communication to better understand how you can modify, grade, what you can do, based on idea and based on every student succeeds act, et cetera, how you can engage your student to make the most meaningful education possible for your child with Down syndrome. And we talk here about equality versus equity. I like to say, you know, I've had a lot of teachers that have said to me, you know, Will gets an iPad and none of the other kids get an iPad when we're doing science. And the other kids want to know why Will gets an iPad and they don't. And I think about it as a kiddo and when I was 7 and I had to get glasses. And so I think about seeing the chalkboard and I needed access to see the chalkboard. So I needed glasses. Well, what would be equal would be for every child in the classroom to have glasses, but not everybody needs glasses. I needed them. And so it's equitable because I got what I needed in order for me to have equal access to what is happening around me. And that's basically when it comes down to helping your students understand and maybe coming from that place. I always use that example and I include myself because I'm not someone with Down syndrome, but we all have things that we may need access to or accommodations or modifications in order to help us access what everyone else is getting access to. These are just some benefits of inclusive education. We talked about that, just higher outcomes in general for the focus student, for all students, increased tolerance and patience and more exposure to diversity, and more exposure, you know, building empathy, less bullying. And for educators, it's a great opportunity to collaborate. Special education, general education to collaborate, to try new practices, to retrofit some of the old things you've been doing and think outside of the box. Take a look at universal design for learning and think how you can shake things up in the classroom to reach the learning profile of every student there. So there are lots of really great benefits for everyone when it comes to inclusion. And, you know, it starts with that positive attitude and belief that we all deserve to be educated alongside one another and that we make the world a better place by doing so. Obviously, special education is very important, but it doesn't have to be a specific place. It can be special education or resources and specialists and educators, it's services and opportunities and collaboration to give this person a special education based on that particular learning profile or disabilities, but it doesn't have to be just a classroom setting. So the more we think about making things a bit more collaborative, working together and creating that inclusive environment, it also takes planning. It takes money for training. It does take some retrofitting with a principal or a district who really wants to embrace inclusion and diversity. And if you feel empowered to have that discussion with an education team or your principal or your school district about how you can work to create a more inclusive environment for all students, we'd be more than happy to partner with you and to help. We've offered inclusion training, diversity training, hands-on accommodations and modifications training to students, paraprofessionals, and we're here to help. And most of the stuff we do is completely free. We do have more intensive training packages that include, you know, for like professional development days, etc. But for the most part, our services are just, we have them here just to support you. And obviously anything we can do to support inclusion, we're here to do it. So please don't hesitate to reach out. We've talked a little bit about differentiated instruction. Again, this is a whole workshop, but of course, when we have learners with different abilities, different learning styles, taking a look at what motivates them, what their strengths are, and shaking things up in the classroom to be able to address those needs is differentiated instruction. And so there are just some different teaching strategies that we will just run through quickly as far as some examples of modifications and accommodations when it comes to differentiated, when it comes to working with a student with an IEP. So as you guys know, most of you know, I'm sure, there is a big difference between accommodations and modifications. Accommodations are we change like the how we present something or the access the student has in order to achieve the same thing. So that student is learning at grade level. That student is expected to complete the same work as the students, but he may need more time. He may need the problems, less problems on a page, extra space or a quiet space in order to in order to do the same work. He may need an audio book, but of the exact same book in order to access the content because maybe there's a visual impairment, et cetera. So that's accommodations we provide in order to help students access the same learning. Modifications change the what. So the changes can be in the level of the content. Students may be reading at a fourth grade level book about Egypt, and there may be a student who is using, a pre-reader book about some very key concepts about Egypt. But they're learning, the same stuff, but in a different way and different, the content's been modified so that it's not as much and there's not as much text and it's more simplified, etc. So that's why with modifications, why we say a student does not have to be learning at grade level in order to still participate. They can be receiving modifications to their schoolwork. We always want to align your goals with Common Core standards. I'm not going to go through that, but there are Common Core connectors that allow you to see what your Common Core standards are in California, and then you can connect those goals to, and I think it's a tiered system. There might be two other examples of, okay, if the student's not learning at this level, how can you connect to this Common Core standard in a different way? And let me see if we've got that website. It's in the California Department of Education. You can just look up Common Core connectors, and they will list them for different subjects, math, literacy, etc. But just make sure that you want your work to the goals, the IEP goals and the work that they're working on to, to tie to the Common Core goals that you're working on with the students in the same classroom. These are just some different adaptions with accommodations and modifications. You can limit distractions and modify the worksheets, reduce the output. Maybe that student only does 3 spelling words instead of 10 or 5 instead of 10. You can use technology. You can use multiple choice format instead of spontaneous answers. So there are different ways you can make different accommodations and modifications. Maybe the student can act out a book report instead of writing a book report. They can draw a picture and label it instead of writing a paragraph. They can use assistive technology to do expressive writing instead of their handwriting, like we talked about before. I have a recommended book, Inclusion in Action, Practical Strategies to Modify Your Curriculum. It is an excellent book about modifications, and she gives tons of super tangible examples. And again, we will email this PDF to everybody so you have all of this stuff in writing and you can take a look at some of the book recommendations that we have for you. Different reading adaptations for our students. Again, working with their strengths and motivators. So incorporating drama, visual aids. They can have pre-read text. Ask factual rather than interpretive questions, right? Very specific. They can have access to a book with highlighted words on there, with a picture, and you're asking maybe a who, what, when, or where, and they can look at the book, they can see the picture of it. You can give a field of 2 choices. There are lots of different ways that you can help build comprehension and reading. You can use Cliff's Notes. Maybe a specialist can write a brief summary if you don't have access to Cliff's Notes. So just different ways to help them grasp those key concepts and start answering those fundamental comprehension questions. writing adaptations, right? Focusing just on core vocabulary, use pictures for inspiration. The child can dictate to a scribe or use a sentence strip with pre-labeled, you know, strips so they can build sentences from there using assistive technology, a sentence starter to kind of help them get going, access to a word bank so they can visually see some options and choices instead of trying to come up with everything right here on the spot, since we know that that's a challenge. Some of those, you know, using a slant board, et cetera, lots of different writing accommodations. Spelling, maybe a kiddo's working on beginning letter sounds and everyone else in the classroom is spelling, you know, pretty long words, but maybe an aide then reads out the spelling word and that student only has to name or type in or dictate the beginning letter, the letter that is associated with that letter sound. So there are different ways. Again, if you're not having to work at grade level, you want to focus on those IEP goals and then try to incorporate those goals into what the other students are working on into that standard core curriculum. And so that's just one specific example about spelling, right? They may just be working on a specific letter sound or maybe a middle vowel sound, et cetera. And they can fill in the blanks or just tell you, they don't have to write it because it's a spelling activity. So reduce that cognitive demand. If it's not just a physical OT writing activity, if it's spelling or expressive writing, give them access to other means of expressing their understanding. We want to make sure we're just sticking with the key goal of the activity itself and not placing extra demands on the students. Science and social studies, it's great to use just key words with visuals that go with it. Just a, like maybe four or five key words, vocabulary words that go with that lesson. And then maybe some visuals or just a short sentence that helps them identify those core vocabulary words. Graphic organizers, having the student draw a picture or make a collage of the topic. They can use pictures, and they're even like those picture, it's like a picture book that you can have recorded. The parent or a teacher or a peer can help them pre-record the pictures, and they can give a report using pictures and pre-recorded voice on there. So there are lots of different ways they can express their knowledge through that. With math, like we said, we have evidence-based math approaches that we use at Down Syndrome Connection. NumaCon is one that I highly recommend you look into if you haven't before. We do loan out NumaCon kits. I have a NumaCon tutorial. It's a 2.5-hour NumaCon workshop. So obviously we don't have enough time to go through the basics of NumaCon today, but just so you know, now that you know we have a lending library, if you would like to know about more evidence-based approaches like NumaCon, again, not curriculum, it's just a manipulative and an approach, I'd be more than happy to share more information with you. But trying to keep math as real as possible, relate it to real life items, use items of interest, help them engage in meaningful ways. Multi-sensory learning approach, reinforced with number lines, reinforced with manipulatives, anything you can do to help reinforce these concepts as much as possible is super, super helpful. Letting your kiddos use a calculator, that's another great tool. And this is just about the NumaCon approach. It's really cool. For those of you who've never looked up NumaCon, it's a pretty cool program. I've been using it for several years with some of my students, and they're making great, great gains. And just remember, communication is so important, especially now while we're in a virtual learning environment or a hybrid environment, making sure that the education team and family are working together, communicating regularly, but not, you know, beyond what is appropriate. Parents understanding that you are you don't have just one student, and you understanding that a parent who has a child with a significant disability may need a little more communication so that they can practice these strategies at home, that they can really help engage with those, you know, with the repetition to make sure that students are retaining that knowledge now that you know seven times a charm, right? And so just agreeing to a communication strategy, to a plan that works for everybody, I think is really, really important. And everyone being on the same page with goals, with challenges, with strengths, with motivators, that is the most important thing. Understanding your student, and so that everyone has a clear idea. This is just an example of an All About Me page for Eli. And this tells all about him, how you can best support him, what are things that are important to him, what are some admirable characteristics about him. For our younger students, you might have strengths, challenges, there might be medical issues or health concerns, so that you can always be mindful of those. And this one, they got pretty creative, and it shows his interests down at the bottom. Like I told you, he loves rock and roll. But again, this is just, again, that collaborative effort between family and education team. The more you guys can all be on the same page, understand the student, know where the challenges are, but also know those strengths and motivators, the more you're going to be able to start getting creative about how you're going to provide the most meaningful instruction you can, and how you're going to communicate with your student, and how you're going to get that student to participate meaningfully in your classroom. We just learned helplessness. We just want to make sure that we're not helping too much. Our students with Down syndrome don't mind being helped out. And if you do it too much, then they can definitely become reliant upon that. So the least dangerous assumption is to assume competence and just provide supports when needed. We're working to foster independence. We want our students with Down syndrome to be able to thrive in their communities when they leave school. So they need to practice, fail, succeed, and build, you know, the understanding, the basic foundational skills of the world around them, so that they can succeed in the real world when they're finished with their education. We want them to be able to tell time, be able to get from point A to point B, have good literacy skills, be able to count their money, navigate, you know, the world around them. So the more we can foster independence and only help when we can really tell that student needs help, that's the best mindset to have when it comes to that. Just making sure that we are remembering that our students with disabilities still, you know, need to have peer social connections. It's super important that they have the opportunity to participate in extracurricular activities, that they have access to the accommodations, the materials they need, access to peer supports, friendships, opportunities for socialization, even in a virtual environment. Because research indicates that 70 to 80% of people with developmental disabilities will be abused either verbally, physically, or sexually in their lifetime, we want to make sure we're using people first language, not the Down syndrome kid in my school. There's a girl with Down syndrome. Her name is Clara. Down syndrome is just one part of who she is. But as teachers and educators, you have to model that awareness, model that people first language. Make sure if you hear any of your kiddos using derogatory words like retarded, that you help them understand why that's an offensive term to someone with a disability. Making sure that we're modeling empathy, respect, appropriate people first language, so that we are creating more empathetic people in this world and less bullies. That's super, super important. And as educators, I know that you know how important that is. And then finally, we just start thinking about transition. So like I said, a student doesn't have to be performing at grade level until they are in high school. And in high school, the family has to determine if they want, and the education team, you guys determine what track that student is on. And then at that point, you really want to start thinking about a meaningful transition. And it's important to include the student as much as you can. It's important to look at that student's strengths and skills, and make sure that you're developing something that is meaningful. We have, you know, a lot of students that have big ideas about what they want to do. And with a mindful transition team, they actually may have access to their dreams. One of our self-advocates and employees at Down Syndrome Connection, she travels around the country. She's with semi-independent living, travels around the country producing movies. She just finished Wrapped with a Disney movie. She was in with a John Travolta movie, I don't know how long ago. And she's constantly traveling the country, living out her dreams because she had a mindful transition team and a mindful family who listened to her and treated her as someone who wanted to be taken seriously, who wanted to have an opportunity to achieve her goals and live a fulfilling life. And having a disability like Down syndrome should never prevent you from doing so. So be mindful about the transition and make sure that you are developing IEP goals that speak to those life skills that are necessary, those critical life skills. Like I said, navigating the world around you, getting from point A to point B, telling time, you know, feeling like a productive member of society, being able to count your money. There are some very foundational skills that I think are fundamental and the most important ones to tie into IEP goals as we're getting into that transition period. And that's what we just kind of went over here. So all of these different basic computer skills and reading and writing and training, travel training skills, money, practice writing resumes, filling out job applications, role-playing interviews. Those are all very important for that meaningful transition for your student with Down syndrome. And then we've got, you know, lots of different resources like the Regional Center. There are different transitional programs around that, and depending on the area you're in, that you can collaborate with as well. And finally, we are at the end. And for you educators who did hang on for a little extra time today, I do thank you so much for participating. We do thank you for all you do. We recognize that you have a lot on your plates, and we appreciate that you want to take the time and the energy to support your student with Down syndrome to the best of your ability. And we hope that you learned some things from today's workshop. And again, please don't hesitate to use us as a resource. Please email me with any questions you may have. I also do Zoom and phone and email consults, training, whatever you need. We may be able to help you out with it. Most of the time we can. So just let us know. And in the meantime, I'll just take a look at our chat here. Thank you so much. You're welcome. Does anyone else have a question? If so, please feel free to type it in the chat area. Now that we are here toward the end. Thank you. Yes, our recordings will be shared. Thank you. We'll have this up on our website. And thank you guys. It looks like, I'm not sure if we have any other questions. Well, thank you guys. I appreciate your feedback. If you do come up with a question and our workshop's over, you know, you can email me with anything you need, and I'll be happy to get back to you as soon as I can. In the meantime, thank you so much. We appreciate your participation today, and we look forward to partnering with your schools and your students to support you in any way we can. So thanks so much. Take care, and we'll see you next time.